Hi everyone, well, welcome back to our laboratory of the endless exploration of Chernobyl technology. Well, I believe many of you have seen the control rooms of the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, well, at least in movies or in pictures, but some of you surely have been lucky enough to visit those places. And most of that is no longer operational, so maybe you've been asked to press or turn some of the controls, such as the famous AZ-5 reactor shutdown switch. But how many of you have wondered what is actually below the control panel and how some of these devices should look when they are operating? So today we'll take a closer look at some of the iconic controls of the Chernobyl reactor consoles. And here we have a few types of switches, a typical optical-mechanical meter, which I have to say is a really interesting thing itself, and also a few control rod buttons. And each of them holds a little secret. And as usual, for the beginning, a quick announcement. So in the next few weeks, we will be presenting a large and very detailed episode about rbmk nuclear reactors, how they were built, how they operate, and how they were controlled. Even more content will be available on our Patreon. The link is in the description below. So those controls are not exclusive to nuclear power plants, but they are mostly used exactly there. Specifically, the rotary switches you see on those consoles are designed solely for energy infrastructure. Luckily, I have a few brand new ones of various types, because there are a few types used, and some are still in their boxes, and there is on one even an inscription to be used at the nuclear power plants. It is also written that they can handle 220 volts or 380 volts at 4 amps, and also can withstand up to 440 volts through their insulation. However, at the same time, the protection glass is just IP30, so it is pretty similar to any household switch or, say, wall socket. So in the box we have just a little stuff, we have just a few screws and the switch itself wrapped in such oiled paper or waxed paper, and as you may have already noticed, the switches they're quite long, and that's because at the nuclear power plants one switch typically has to simultaneously connect or disconnect many circuits at once, so this requires numerous contact groups installed inside. Well, please feel free to correct me in the comments if I use the terminology not really correctly, but some switches have multiple positions, some have a fixation when turned, and some have, say, auto-return, so allowing you to activate them only for a short time while holding them in your hand, and later on you will see that it is also possible to adjust them, so you can modify and make many variations. So let's take a look inside this very switch, which is pretty the same as the AZ-5 emergency shutdown switch. The contact pins are placed beneath two protective covers, and wires should pass through this circular opening at the bottom. So to access all that, we need to remove these two nuts. And inside, in this very switch, we find six contact groups. There can be more of them, less of them, depends on a specific modification. And below is a white ring that secures the wires when they're installed, so let's remove that as well. In fact, all parts here are held in place by two long threaded studs, and due to the limited space here, I will be using a wrench bit to remove that. Luckily, it is not very tight. So inside there is a baculite square-shaped axis that controls the rotation, and these are the contact groups. And the corresponding part has a positioning mechanism. Well, I must say it takes quite a bit of force to turn it, which probably in some cases could be an added safety countermeasure against the accidental triggering. It's just a guess, but probably that was the intentional thing of this design. Alright, so this part of mechanism was secured with this very interesting nut, which is a little bit submerged, so that took pretty an effort to remove it. And this is what we have inside. So notice there's two metal stoppers and a set of holes around. So the thing is, you can alter the available rotation positions by relocating the stoppers. This very switch has three positions enabled. And also below is a mechanism of the instant action and a very powerful spring. Well, so that's it, yeah? Reassembling of it is pure pleasure, very simple, very straightforward. You know, I believe we'll be using a few of those switches in our future projects. So, on the same panel, you'll find many of this kind of buttons, which are part of the control rod control system. In fact, you can find them in many other places across the control room, and they normally come in 5 colors: red, yellow, green, blue, and white. Sometimes they can be darker or lighter, and the shorter ones are momentary, while the longer ones are toggle switches. And they are technically based on 2 microswitches of this kind, which I have to say are very reliable. But here is one secret you probably didn't know. If you open the cap, you will find a light bulb secured right in the center. Well, you also can change these caps to different color. So, well, in the green one, I don't have a lamp, so that's what it looks like. This light bulb is typically used in aviation equipment, so it requires 27 volts. It is possible to replace it also with LED, but that would, you know, require some playing with the modifications of the pins, and it should be positioned straight in the center. So, unfortunately, I have only 9 volt power source, so it barely glows, but you can get the idea. So, these buttons at the power plant panel, they are not only buttons, they are also indicators, and they are pretty important. Okay, now let's move on the most interesting piece of hardware, this meter. Well, you'll find thousands, if not hundreds of them, in the reactor control room. Well, they have a very narrow shape, which makes them very convenient for stacking in big numbers. But they occupy an unusually deep space inside the panel, because they have a technology that requires this size. So, let's open it up and see what's inside. Well, the upper cover is secured with some enormous number of screws, and the reason is that the device is well protected from moisture. That's because that apart from nuclear power plants and energy installations, those are also used in marine environments. And the thing is that this meter indicates values using light beam. Inside, there is a complex optical system. So, on the back there is a light bulb that has a mask in front of it. It projects light onto a mirror. Then there is a lens that focuses that light onto another, but this time rotative mirror, which projects it already on the screen. Well, I'm certain that similar devices existed in the West, so, well, let me know in the comments if they did and how similar they were. Well, as for those 2 things around it, I'm honestly not sure. I will check them out as well, but a little bit later. For now, let's try to activate the device. Well, it appeared that the light bulb is non-functional, and as you can see, it is a little bit special. It has a 3 watt power, so pretty much, and that ring around it positions it exactly in the center. So, well, I made such a makeshift solution where crowd took a less powerful light bulb, which is powered by the 4.5 volt battery. Well, by the way, this battery has a real challenge to get somewhere for sale. But I will need it for one of my future videos. It will be a bit nostalgic one, so I'm sure you will enjoy it. So, once we install the lamp, we can see the mark. Have to say, it should be much, much brighter, of course, something this way. And now, let's attempt to measure something. So, while this device has a scale in percentage, it's actually a milliampere meter. So, I've taken a power supply from my Arduino kit, which I often use for various tests and experiments, and since, unfortunately, I don't have any spare potentiometer, I will place here a photoresistor. So, let's connect and see. And here, as you can see, we have the light beam moving back and forth. And I will try also to show you the mirror moving. So there it is. Well, I have to say, I absolutely love how it looks. And, you know, imagine all those panels active when there are many of them. That should be really impressive. You know, in fact, there is a very short footage where you can see that in action. It's very badly visible, but here it is. Okay, now let's take a look at those things on the sides. Well, I suppose that those are some sort of beam position trackers because there are wires coming from them and they are exactly on the edges. Okay, so it's open. So that's indeed a position tracker, but frankly I didn't expect to see something like this. So here is a perforated film with a set of photoresistors, and just a moment. So on the another side there is the same thing, but the green one. I got it. So by rotating these two screws, I somehow missed them. You can move the green and red films, and you can this way define a green and red zone of measurements. So the idea is that when the beam is inside these zones, you'll be able to detect it because it will trigger those resistors. And in other words, the meter can be used as an executive device. Well, I find this a little bit, you know, ridiculous technology, but that's really interesting, I have to say. Well, so pretty cool stuff, right? So please let us know in the comments if you'd like to have more this kind of devices explained in the future videos. And in the meantime, check our other episodes on our channel and also on Patreon page, because we have a lot of epic Chernobyl things out here. So that's it for today, and see you next time.